It's my great pleasure to welcome all of you to the 6th annual conference of the Julia Rabinowitz Center for Public Policy and Finance. I just want to say a few words to get this started. So this center was established by in 2011, thanks to a generous gift of the Julius family. Actually, I think Mitch Julius, the donor, is also here. So Mitch is there. And also, I should remind you that we are in this beautiful building for the Econ Department and this really nice conference room. And in this building called, actually, also Julius Rabinowitz Building. Again, thanks to Mitch. All right. So. This conference is about China. I'm sure everybody knows a lot of things are happening about China. So let me, without any delay, so I think everybody probably anxious to find out, are we going to have a trade war, if not a real war with China, right? So let me give it to JC to start the presentation.
Great, thanks so much. My name is JC DeSwan, and it's my pleasure to introduce our first panel on China's international economy and politics. So we have three panelists. They're going to speak for about 20 minutes each, and then at the end of the third presentation, we'll open it up to question and answers and comments. So we start with big topics. Thomas Christensen is going to start by talking about US-China relations and specifically about the South China Sea disputes. Then we will have William Kirby, who will talk about one aspect of China's soft power, which is its higher education, and specifically about the rise of Chinese universities and their internationalization. And then Dan Rosen will talk, I guess, contemplate the possibility of China stepping in, filling in the US's economic shoes, and stepping up its leadership in globalization. So let me start by introducing Thomas Christensen. Let me mention that he is the William P. Boswell Professor of World Politics of Peace and War and the director of the China and World Program here at Princeton. And you have the bios, but let me just also mention one thing, is that he served from 2006 to 2008 as the Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for East Asian and Asia, East Asian and Pacific Affairs. So he was responsible for relations with China, Taiwan, and Mongolia. And so he combines his academic perspective with a very deep experience dealing with these issues. So Tom, I'll let you.
Thanks so much, JC. Thanks to Wei Xiong, and thanks to Violetta Rosenthal, who really got me involved in this and helped put together our panel. She's done tireless work in behalf of this conference. Tremendous honor for me to speak to you all today. I am of the opinion that the real security challenges attendant to China's rise have to do with sovereignty disputes in East Asia and how they're handled. And I differ from some of my colleagues. I don't think China is poised to become a global superpower rival of the United States anytime soon, and I don't believe that China is likely to dominate East Asia anytime soon. But I do think that there's a real chance that we could see conflicts in East Asia over the many disputes, and that those conflicts could destabilize a region that is of great importance not just to China but to the United States and to several U.S. allies in East Asia, to include Japan, South Korea, the Philippines, Australia, Thailand. So this is a really important issue. I think it's an issue to focus on. And I can't focus on all of the sovereignty disputes today. I'll just mention all the ones that worry me. But I'm going to focus on the South China Sea in particular, because that's the one that's been in the news the most recently. And I'll talk a bit about what I see as the problem. Why I think it's a big problem for U.S. foreign policy and policy of U.S. allies and for China itself. And I'll also talk about some of my prescriptions From my own personal viewpoint, I have to say, since I still advise the U.S. government, the State Department, and the Pentagon, that all my views are just my own. I'm not representing anything about U.S. policy in my comments. One of the complicating factors about the sovereignty disputes in East Asia, which really go from the East China Sea between Japan and China in what are called the Senkaku or Diaoyu Islands, depending on whether you're Japanese or Chinese, in the Taiwan Strait, which is a different kind of sovereignty dispute between Taiwan and the mainland about what the meaning of China's of Taiwan's existence, political existence is. There's a dispute about that, which is a type of sovereignty dispute. And then in the South China Sea, it's complicated by the fact that the United States is a major actor in the region, has allies that are impacted by these disputes, or security partners in the case of Taiwan that are impacted by these disputes. And it's also complicated by the fact that, with the exception of the Senkaku Islands, the U.S. doesn't really take any position on the sovereignty disputes. And people don't really realize that. The United States is involved in them, but it doesn't take any position on who has sovereign control of any of the disputed areas, the features or the waters around them. It just makes certain demands about how those disputes are settled, the Senkakus being the exception, because the Senkakus were transferred back to Japan as part of the Okinawa reversion, and the United States, across administrations, has recognized Japanese administrative control and therefore recognizes that the U.S.-Japan alliance applies to those islands. And that's unlike all of the other disputes, Taiwan and the South China Sea disputes, where the U.S. takes no position on sovereignty about the disputes. Today, again, I'll talk about the South China Sea disputes. This is the nine dash line, what you see up there on the map. This line, can you still hear me if I walk away from the microphone? This line encompasses most of the South China Sea. You'll see the disputed Spratly Islands here. You'll see the Paracel Islands up here in the northern part of the South China Sea. And these are called the Zhongsha or Marlborough. This is Scarborough Reef, where there's a conflict. Macclesfield Bank, I'm sorry. Zhongsha Islands or Macclesfield Bank. So those are also disputed areas in the South China Sea. And China's claims are expansive. They're historic. They go back before the PRC was created to the KMT predecessor government. They were really drawn in the 1930s. They became part of the 1947 Republic of China Constitution. The map was included in that process. And the Chinese communists inherited that map and take that position. And that's why, of the six disputants, both Taiwan, what self-called Republic of China, and the People's Republic of China basically have the same claims in the South China Sea, because it goes back in Chinese history. Now, I'm going to show you a dispute map, if I can. Next slide. Okay, this is the dispute. Now you see China's nine dash line here in red, and you see the other disputants. Taiwan is basically the same as PRC because it has the same history. You see Brunei with this rectangle here. You see Malaysia with this one. You see Vietnam's very expansive claims all the way out to here. So it's not only China that has expansive claims. Vietnam has expansive claims. And you have the Philippines claims in yellow, which is kind of a rectangle. And of all the claimants, really the Philippines is the only one that has adjusted its claims in to be consistent with modern international law. So the Philippines should get a kind of a gold star for making an adjustment in their historic claims. No one else has done that, and basically everyone else has refused to do that. What makes these issues very important are that these sea lanes are very important to international commerce. You'll hear discussions of that. The conflicts out there would be very damaging to the international economy. And again, the United States has an ally in the Philippines, and it cares about its ability to operate militarily in the South China Sea for reasons I will cite in a moment. The sovereignty disputes are particularly knotty compared to other types of disputes, in part because sovereignty is so important to all the states in this area because of a legacy of post-colonial nationalism. So in the domestic politics of all the countries, protecting sovereignty is kind of job one. A second issue, and I take no comfort in this, is that all of the actors in the region, in my impression, really believe that their claims are legitimate. Nobody's faking it. Why do I take no comfort in that? Maybe you should take comfort in that, because it means no one's an aggressor. No one's trying to change the perceived status quo. I take no comfort in it because we know from human psychology studies, including the Nobel Prize-winning work of Princeton's own Daniel Kahneman and Amos Tversky out at Stanford, whom he worked with, that humans of all types, different ethnic groups, different genders, have been proven in laboratories to take bigger risks and pay higher costs to defend what they think is legitimately theirs than they do to get new stuff. And the problem in the South China Sea is everybody believes their overlapping claims are legitimately there. So they're more likely to take high risks and pay high costs to defend them than if they actually thought they were sneaking around and getting something new. That applies to China. The only diplomats I haven't really spoken to are the Brunei diplomats. I don't know how passionately they feel about it. But I can say for all the other disputants, including at least some members of the Taiwan elite, this is a real issue that they really believe is legitimate and is theirs. Okay. The facts on the ground are also complicated because various claimants, not just China, but most recently China and most spectacularly China, have tried to change facts on the ground by building artificial islands and building out on existing features to create occupied features in the disputed area. China did it last among the disputants, but as China does these things, China did it big, massively big, and now outstrips everybody by a lot in this artificial island building campaign, which is understandably considered obnoxious and provocative by all of the other claimants. In addition, China has sort of promised not to militarize the artificial islands, but it sort of broke that promise already, and it's almost certain to break that promise long into the future by building long runways, hardened bunkers, and all the stuff you need to militarily use the artificial islands for defense and for power projection. The fact that the United States takes no position on any of the claims is a complicating factor because it's not really clear what and when the United States would get involved. And at the end of the day, the United States is the strongest military actor in the South China Sea to this day. So that's a wild card that leads to uncertainty. And here we are at this wonderful economic center. So you know that uncertainty causes problems. Right? And the fact that the United States doesn't have clear positions, it doesn't back its own ally, the Philippines, on its claims. All it says is claims, disputes should be handled peacefully and should be handled in a way that's consistent with international law. Right? That's not crystal clear. Right? That's not crystal clear. So, we have problems. And what are the U.S. stakes in all of this? The United States has a huge stake in peace and stability in East Asia. If there were fighting over the South China Sea, that would be extremely bad for peace and stability in East Asia. And it has reputational consequences for the U.S. alliance system if the U.S. allows its allies like the Philippines or like Japan in the East China Sea or even a security partner like Taiwan to be bullied by a rising China. China seems like the actor that's most likely to use force to change the status quo in the region in the sense of maybe knocking someone off a holding, an island that they've occupied or built. The Vietnamese have built up island holdings. The Filipinos have. The Malaysians have. If someone's going to use force to change that, it hasn't happened to date. China seems the most likely to do it, in part because China simply is the most capable of doing it. So that's a concern. So the United States has, I think, wisely said, we have no stake in how these things are settled, but just make sure that everybody agrees on the settlement and that it be done peacefully, and then there should be very few implications for the United States. There is a limit to that, and that is the second interest of the United States is in freedom of navigation. And this issue has been clouded a lot by people who focus on economics. So maybe it's a good thing at a conference like this to have some security geek like myself speaking instead of an economist. A lot of people who emphasize economics say something that on the face of it looks ridiculous to most Chinese observers and looks silly to a lot of non-Chinese observers. And that is the argument that the South China Sea is the busiest sea lane in the world with anywhere from $5 to $7 trillion of trade every year traveling through those waters. And that, therefore, the United States has an interest in preserving commercial freedom of navigation in those waters for the sake of the global economy. All that is true. But there's nobody who's going to intentionally block commercial traffic in the South China Sea, least of all China. Because most of that seaborne traffic in the South China Sea is coming and going to China or to one of China's major trading partners. So it's kind of a red herring for American strategists, admirals, to testify to Congress that there's this tremendous risk that China is not just going to shoot itself in the foot, but shoot itself in the head by blocking commercial traffic in the South China Sea. So what is the real issue about freedom of navigation? And it is a real issue. It has to do with military freedom of navigation. China has a different interpretation of the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. And its nine-dash line is extremely poorly defined, and China refuses to clarify it about what it means. Is everything inside of it sovereign waters? Is it just the features? What kind of rights are passed by those features? Are those rights claimed by China consistent with international law or not? And China has a tradition of a very expansive interpretation of the UN Convention of the Law of the Sea to include the demand that all foreign militaries ask for permission in China's exclusive economic zone, which many of you will know casts 200 nautical miles off of sufficiently large land features. So under that theory, the US Navy and the Air Force could be challenged on a frequent and regular basis simply by operating in this giant chunk of water that connects security partners like Singapore to security allies like Japan in a global network of American power projection that is the sole strength of the United States and what makes the United States much more powerful than any potential rival in the military sphere, is that network. In addition, if the United States was unable to operate in the South China Sea, it would be very difficult to demonstrate to East Asian allies or anybody else that the United States is a reliable ally that can't be backed down by another power. So the United States freedom of navigation issue, correctly viewed, and this is my opinion, is about the freedom of navigation of the US military. China is not going to block commercial traffic. So the third related issue is rule of law. Are China's claims and the other claimants' claims consistent with the UN Convention of the Law of the Sea? And when I say claims, I'm not referring to the actual geographic features that are claimed, because the UN Convention of the Law of the Sea says nothing about those. What it talks about is the rights that are afforded to a country that makes a claim. So if you claim an island, and it's really an island judged under international law, it has a 12 nautical mile territorial sea, and it casts a 200 nautical mile EEZ. Exclusive economic zone. If it is a rock, not a rock, but a rock, if it's a rock, right, it casts a 12 nautical mile sea and no EEZ. And if it's an underwater feature, a low tide elevation that at low tide has nothing protruding, or at high tide has nothing protruding, it's a low tide elevation, at high tide has nothing protruding, it casts nothing. Not 12 nautical mile sea, and no EEZ. So are the claims and the rights being claimed from those claims consistent with international law? This is really important to the United States, even though the United States hasn't ratified, unfortunately, UNCLOS. It has signed on to it, but it hasn't ratified it. This is the basis of U.S. strategy around the world, and the South China Sea is no exception. There was a ruling in 2015 by the International Tribunal of the Law of the Sea at the Philippines' behest that basically said that the Chinese nine-dash line itself is not based in international law. It's basically illegal. That building of building islands on low tide elevations, those things that don't stick out at high tide, in the Philippines EEZ, in areas like here, is illegal at a place called Mischief Reef. That was built in the 1990s, and that up here in Macclesfield Bank in the Zhongsha area in Scarborough Shoal, that China should allow the Filipinos the right to fish in this lagoon that the Chinese sealed off in 2012. So the ruling went totally against China, and China was very upset about it and rejects it. So what is a U.S. strategy? And I'll finish with this. What is a wise U.S. strategy given these problems? I think the U.S. strategy should be stability-based and law-based. The U.S. should stay out of the sovereignty disputes entirely. Don't take the temptation of listening to one claimant say, our claims are more reasonable than someone else's claims. They're all somewhat spotty. The Chinese claims, particularly in the Spratlys, are particularly spotty, but they're all somewhat spotty. And the U.S. shouldn't get involved in it. But demand peaceful resolution. Be consistent and firm on the interpretation of the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, and continue to do freedom of navigation operations, which were started in the Obama administration in the second term, to demonstrate that the U.S. rejects what are called excessive claims projected from any island or any artificial island, right? By operating the U.S. military in a way that is somewhat annoying to the claimant it's targeted at, but it's not particularly provocative in a military sense in almost all instances, but shows that the United States doesn't recognize these expansive, excessive claims. I wish the United States would do this more regularly and much more quietly. What happened in the Obama administration is it was done rarely, it was done relatively late, and it was done with a tremendous amount of machismo and coverage in the front page of the New York Times, which kind of runs against the whole idea of freedom of navigation operations, which are basically saying, this is normal behavior, we're going to keep doing it. You shouldn't have the Secretary of Defense involved, flying onto a carrier. You shouldn't have it in the front page of the Times, because all you're doing is putting China's face on the line in an unnecessary fashion. They will know you're there. Right? They have surveillance equipment. Your allies, if they don't know you're there, you can tell them. We were there. No one stopped us. So it works out just fine. Basically, my bumper sticker is do more, say less. Seize on the opportunity of Chinese bullying of the other claimants, which has occurred, to strengthen U.S. relations with the neighboring countries. And I think over time, China will get the message that it's not worth the candle to alienate its neighbors and drive them into the arms of the Americans. The real goal of that is not to create a giant containment alliance against China. The real goal of that is to remind China that there are clear costs to trying to settle these disputes through coercion or through occupation. Try to get others to participate in those types of freedom of navigation operations because they're based in international law, not on an individual country's interpretation of that law. So there's no reason why even European countries can't do freedom of navigation operations in the South China Sea. And I just finished by saying the United States should be consistent, and the United States hasn't been consistent. If the United States is going to base its strategy in the South China Sea and around the world in maritime disputes on the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea and interpretation of it, the U.S. needs to be consistent. So when U.S. allies have excessive claims, the U.S. should speak up. And the Japanese have an excessive claim in a place called Okinotorishima, and the United States tends to stay quiet about it. I think that's a mistake. These are artificial islands built by Japan, our ally, on a rock. Not a rock, but a rock. in the Western Pacific. I'm not going to draw it up here. It's not that important where it is. But they have very excessive claims by law of the sea. And the United States should do freedom of navigation operations not only by China's artificial islands, but also by everyone else's.
So we ought to be cruising by the Vietnamese ones, cruise by the Filipino ones. Just say we're operating here. We don't care about these artificial lines. It's not a China thing. It's a law thing. So as long as the U.S. is consistent, principled, and smart, I'm hopeful that this very dangerous situation, which could escalate, and it could escalate in part because China's been using non-naval forces, Coast Guard, fishermen, armed fishermen, these people's militia, this maritime militia. These are fishermen with guns, and fishermen are tough already. You give fishermen guns, there's real trouble. So these are people basically working for the Chinese government. That it's a real chance for friction. Friction can always lead to escalation. And I think it's a manageable problem, and I'll just finish by saying, I think the U.S. goal is achievable if it's properly structured. The U.S. goal ought to be the disputes don't get settled by force or coercion. Right? They still exist. It's a nasty thing. And two, the United States military has freedom of navigation. No one should try to stop the U.S. Navy from operating in the South China Sea. It's a bad bet for any Navy, including the Chinese Navy, to challenge the U.S. Navy or Air Force from operating in international waters. So I think those are achievable if the U.S. is resolute, clear, and restrained. There's no need for macho statements, slogans. There's no need for rebalance, pivot. Just do it. Just do it. All right. Thanks so much for your attention.
We're going to switch gears with our next speaker, William Kirby, who is going to talk about Chinese higher education. I'll just mention that he is the T.M. Chang Professor of China Studies at Harvard University and the Spangler Family Professor of Business Administration at HBS. Given the topic that he's going to discuss, let me just mention the fact that he also serves as faculty chair of the Harvard Center in Shanghai, and he has served as the Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences at Harvard. So, Bill, you have 20 minutes, and let me can someone help me with this to bring the slides here?
Something less conflictual.
Okay.
Now, the Philippines adjusted to be consistent with UN Convention Law.
So you see it's rectangular?
Yeah, the top part. Where does the Vietnam cushion start?
Oh, the purple goes around. Oh, just.
Yeah, the top part.
Yeah, I don't know. It might overlap. It's a good question. You should have a better map. I don't know exactly where it goes. It goes in that direction. It certainly goes up to the parasol. Yeah, it goes up to the parasol.
The parasols are included by the Vietnam.
There we go. Thank you. Okay. Great. Well, thank you very much for this invitation. It's an honor to be here. And I'm so glad that Tom has solved the South China. As Chiang Kai-shek wrote that nine-dash line.
Jejuela.
I mean, it's really, really wonderful, wonderful to see. I'm going to talk about, I think, what's a cheerier topic here in a university setting, which is higher education. But it's basically the three of us are in each way taking a different tack on the question that is in so many people's minds is, you know, is how is China rising? Is China rising to be the global power in the 21st century? Is, by contrast, this country in comparative decline? Power is measured by many things, but it's measured by more than economics and power politics. It's also measured in human exchange, the power to attract investment, the power to educate human capital, and the capacity to set global standards. And a couple years ago, I and several of my HBS colleagues wrote a book called Can China Lead? trying to articulate what leadership means in a global context. And among the things that it does mean, what it includes is education, in some sense. The leaders of the 19th and 20th century globally, broadly speaking, if you look at Britain, Germany, and the United States, were all in their time also acknowledged leaders, pace setters, global trend setters in higher education, and the place of first resort of people who wished to be educated around the world. And at first glance, if we look at the world today, it seems that the United States is dominating our educational and cultural relations. If we look just at the foot traffic, at the beginning of the 21st century, Chinese students constituted approximately 10% of all international students in American institutions. Today, this share of Chinese students is now 31%. India, a different second, with 17%. Chinese students contribute about one-third of the total international student payments to American universities. And in this last academic year, nearly 330,000 Chinese students were enrolled in American colleges and universities. Again, more than about a third of the total number of international students in the United States. Why is this happening? Is it because China lacks a sufficient number of university places for graduates of its high schools? No, just the opposite. Is it because China lacks good or even great universities? Again, no, I would argue. Just the opposite. We are witnessing in the realm of education, as we have in power politics, as we have in business, a rise of China that is not the last 20 or 30 or 35 or 45 years in the making. It's been a century in the making. If Chiang Kai-shek could outline that nine-dash line, it was because China in 1945 had already stood up, had already outlasted Japan in the Second World War, and was already a great power. And the same is true in some regard if one looks at the realm of education. If we were to go back 100 years ago, of course, Chinese education, this was an examination compound last used in 1905, the end of the Qing examinations. And these are, if you were a student taking this examination, you would walk through this door, walk through here, go into one of these little cubicles, and you'd stay there for 3 days, and you'd bring your own food, your own water, and your own waste bucket. And the only way, actually, to get out is to die. And it's a secure thing. And if you died during the exam, they would throw your body over the wall. So when I hear people today complaining about SATs or GATs, give me a break. You have no idea. But this was, in some sense, in education, as in so many things, China has the longest continuous tradition of veneration of education. This is a millennium-long system from Song times to late Qing times. It would end overnight in 1905. But in some sense, never in world history has there been a greater ideal for education. Good people reading great books in order to do good work in government. Imagine such a thing in this country.
Just books.
In any event, I digress. This ends in 1905, and it's replaced by a quite different set of systems, by an international system. Modern Chinese higher education was among the most dynamic, if small, systems of higher education in the world in the first half of the 20th century, with outstanding universities, public and private, Chinese and foreign. And once again, despite the disasters of Maoist period, Chinese universities are again back, now on a large scale and on a global scale. Chinese students come to the United States today for a variety of reasons, some of which are rooted in history. Before the communist takeover of China, the United States was already both a leading destination of Chinese who studied abroad and a major power in Chinese higher education. For example, Yanjing University is the campus today of Peking University, Beida, but a Sino-foreign joint venture. You can see here it says Yanjing Dashui, Yanjing University here, although the English name is Peking University. These beautiful buildings venerated today as wonderful Chinese architecture are actually the creation of an American architect who set up this campus. Every major Chinese university today is international in architectural and intellectual foundations. True of Peking University here in 1926 and today. True of Jinling College, now part of Nanjing University, which had as a sister college, Smith College in Massachusetts, as women's colleges. Or National Central University, established by Chiang Kai-shek in 1930, modeled on the best university in the world in 1930. So what is the best university in the world in 1930? Let me ask you guys.
Princeton.
No, I've asked that question, Tom, in a variety of settings around the world, and no one has ever given that answer. Well, what'd you say is the best university in the world?
Cambridge
would be a reasonable guess, but be wrong. Does that look like Cambridge or Oxford? No. What does it look like? So the best university in the world, this is a national central university, Zhongyang Daxue, is modeled on the greatest university in the world, the father of all modern research universities, founded in 1810, not an ancient university. And it's the University of Bergen, the mother of all modern universities. And you know that Zhongyang Daxue is founded on the model of the University of Bergen because there's a Brandenburg Gate welcoming you into it. Now it's part of Dongnan Daxue. But as Nanjing University has built a new campus, they built a new Brandenburg Gate welcoming you into it. German universities, one should say, and this shows you how the world changes. German university, if we had the kind of rankings that we have today, 8 out of the top 10 universities in the world as late as 1930, but definitely say by the 19, before the First World War, 8 of the top 10 in the world would have been German universities. Today, only one German university regularly ranks in the top 50 in the world. Times change, as we shall see. And they change also at places like this. This is Tsinghua University, founded in 1911 as a place, as Tsinghua Shuetang, to send Chinese away, a place to a prep school to send Chinese to the United States, founded in the last month of the last year of the last emperor of the last dynasty in China, and founded in some sense as a Midwestern American university, in some sense. Modeled in physical terms on the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. The main auditorium is a replica of Urbana-Champaign's, in part because it is the president of Urbana-Champaign who convinced Theodore Roosevelt to remit Boxer indemnity funds to fund this extraordinary operation. My teacher in Chinese history, John Fairbank, learned his Chinese history at Tsinghua University in 1930s, in the early 1930s, from a great Chinese scholar, Zhang Tingfu, who himself had studied at Oberlin and at Columbia. The intersection, in other words, of American and Chinese higher education was central in many ways to the excellence of them both. The first five individuals of Chinese background from the mainland, Hong Kong, or Taiwan, who earned Nobel Prizes in the sciences, had all either studied or taught at American universities. And one can see in physical sense the remnants of an earlier period of exchange. If you visit the Harvard campus, and I'm sure there's something like this at Princeton too, but there's a stele put up by the Chinese students of the Chinese Student Association of the Republic of China at Harvard in 1936 in the calligraphy of Hu Shi, saying, "But it is by virtue of its culture that a nation rises, but it is truly due to learning that a culture flourishes." It says that in classical Chinese, but it's worth visiting right next to the Widener Library. So the flow of Chinese to the United States today is built in part on these past experiences, but of course it's at a much larger scale than ever before. And this is in part it's in part a sign of weakness in some sense in China itself. Parents seeking to get their kids and their money out at a time of political uncertainty. Perhaps one could argue that in China. But it is also because of the expansion, quality, and breadth of education in contemporary China. China's public high schools now rank among the best in the world. Their graduates qualify for admission to the world's most competitive colleges. Chinese university graduates are competitive to enter the world's leading doctoral programs. And the high percentage of Chinese in American PhD programs, which admits students only on the basis of pure academic merit, is proof of their quality. And in 2016, Chinese doctoral students accounted for 34% of all first-year international doctoral students in the United States. And because nobody can graduate from a Chinese university without having passed an English language examination, Chinese graduate students are linguistically capable of handling the challenge of studying in the United States. So we've seen China go through many educational transformations. An American-style university at Tsinghua. You can follow the trajectory of Chinese higher education by its architecture, because Tsinghua University goes from being Urbana-Champaign to being Moscow State in the 1950s, to being what it is today, a great, and we'll come up to some other pictures, a great and remarkable comprehensive university. And this investment in education, the sending of all these students abroad, 300,000, people have argued that it's a terrible brain drain. And I personally don't think that's true. If you look at the entire history of Chinese-American educational intersection, you can think of the United States as a kind of a brain bank for China. The number of people returning every year from the United States who have been educated here is about the same as the ones who come here. And they will work and thrive at places like Tsinghua and elsewhere, who almost exclusively appoint only American PhDs to their faculty positions. So if you look at the world, again, rankings, there's an obsession with rankings. These rankings didn't even exist 17 years ago, any one of these systems of rankings. Times Higher Education, however, has Beida is number 29 in the world. Tsinghua is number 35 in the world. Tsinghua outdoing them in the QS rankings. Presidents and deans, I tell you, focus big on this stuff, and even more do their boards of trustees and party secretaries. The Peking University, number 39. Shanghai Jiao Tong is a little meaner to Chinese universities in its rankings. This is the first global system of ranking. U.S. News and World Report also has Beida and Tsinghua way above many leading American universities in this. It doesn't tell you anything in particular, but it tells you that the tectonic plates of international higher education are shifting, and they're shifting with some great speed. Now, the challenge really for China's competitiveness in higher education probably comes down to the most simple of questions. The resources are there, the human talent is massively there, particularly among the students. The question will come down to, can world-class universities, however they are defined, exist in a politically illiberal system? Maybe, but only with some significant degree of autonomy. German universities in the 19th century faced many political pressures, but they were the envy of the world in part because they had traditions of institutional freedom that fostered and at times mostly protected creative thinkers, and at times famously did not. Chinese universities today boast superb scholars and among the world's absolute best students. But these students are forced to sit through required courses on party ideology and politics, and they're forced to learn a comic book version of the history of their own country. So perhaps it is by default, then, that our American universities still enjoy our hour in the sun as innovative places to send, that parents send their children to educate leaders. I'm sure this is true of Princeton, it's true of Harvard. There isn't a single American university that doesn't claim to educate leaders. Nobody seems to go for the much larger market of followers. But you learn a lot about where people send their kids to university. Chiang Kai-shek sent his two sons to study at the two leading powers of his day, to the Soviet Union, Zhang Jingguo, and to Germany, Zhang Weiguo, who studied in the Kriegsschule München. And today, the sons and daughters of China's most powerful political figures, President Xi Jinping and his arch-rival, Bo Xilai, studied, both of them, their kids studied at Harvard. We are an equal opportunity university for every faction in the Chinese Communist Party. You know, how long will this last? Let me just close in some with a few quick pictures here. American universities have been the envy of the world in the second half of the 20th century. But we have to recognize this was not true in the 19th century, and there are no guarantees for the rest of the 21st century. If we look, see, the world is now coming to China and to invest in China. The University of Nottingham investing in Ningbo, the university and the with an exact replica of the University of Nottingham, University of Liverpool in Suzhou. Stanford University has a Sukhyuan, a courtyard campus on Beida's campus, Peking University's campus. China Europe Business School, one of the best business schools in the world, a joint venture between the European Union and China in Shanghai and a beautiful campus by IMPEI. Columbia has offices in Beijing. Chicago has a center at People's University. NYU Shanghai is up and running as a liberal arts college. The Harvard Center Shanghai, which I oversee, sadly does not control that entire building, but we're on one floor of it, where we do executive education and serious research. But it's the only university-wide center of my university anywhere in the world, and we chose to put it in China. Duke University, the most ambitious of any American university by some measure, establishing in Kunshan, the richest small city in China, only 13 minutes by high-speed rail from Shanghai, a liberal arts college opened a year and a half ago. This is the first phase one, now up and running, an absolutely stunningly beautiful place. And this is the larger plan for a 200 acre residential college to build a world-class liberal arts college within the People's Republic of China. Incredible ambitious and great for Duke, and if it works, very, very good for China as well. And then this is something that Tom and I have both been part of as advisors to Schwarzman College at Tsinghua University. This is Liu Yandong, Vice Premier, inaugurating this enterprise a few years ago in the Great Hall of the People, a mock-up of what would be, and what this is aspirational. It just opened this fall. It is the Rhodes Scholarship of the 21st century. American businessman Stephen Schwarzman, whom you may have read about in other contexts more recently, in helping Mr. Trump, Mr. Schwarzman has endowed and raised enormous amounts of money to build in China a place where the best and the brightest of the world will go, on the presumption that the world's leaders of the 21st century, they're not want to go for a postgraduate year or two to this declining, rainy, foggy island off the coast of Europe. No roads. You will go to Beijing instead, and you will go and you'll be housed in a magnificent building here, which, among other things, has state-of-the-art air filtration. think of how the world is changing. I've never seen a program like this. Tom and I worked very hard in the setup process. I've never seen a program where we had a 3% admission rate in its first year, and a 96% yield of those admitted. And it's better than Harvard College, better than Harvard Business School, better probably even than Princeton in this regard. So Tsinghua, let me now close, a place founded to send Chinese away, now attracts the best and the brightest from around the world. And it did so by raising money and getting advice from the United States, raising a lot of money, $400 million. It and its fellow Chinese university across the street, Beida, with its Yanjing program, these are early signs, again, of this massive but clear shift in global higher education. Leadership in the world in anything is comparative. If you look at American higher education, we still seem to be doing well in global markets. But if you look at the crisis in public higher education in this country, the slow motion decline of the University of California system as the greatest example. The University of California system declines, as it is doing and as it will likely continue to do, then Princeton and Harvard will decline as well, because we compete for the same faculty and the same graduate students with the UC. So, can China lead in the realm of higher education? Perhaps. Can America lose its leadership position? Absolutely. But that's another talk for another time. Thank you very much.
Pull up the slides. Thank you. International economics. Our next speaker, Dan Rosen, is going to talk about the ability of China to take on increasing leadership in globalization. Dan is the co-founder of Rhodium, an independent research group where he leads the work on China and the world economy. And I'll just mention of relevance, Dan worked at the National Economic Council and the National Security Council and had played a key role during the accession of China to the WTO. Dan, you have 20 minutes.
There we go. Thank you very much, JC, and thank you to friends here at Princeton for asking me to come down and join you for this really cool get-together of some terrific people to talk about what's happening in China. We're kicking off here this afternoon thinking about China's political and now economic footprint in the world economy and in the world broadly at an extraordinary moment when there's a lot of moving pieces in terms of what that international landscape looks like. You know, my whole career, just about 25 years now, a number of my mentors are in the room, including Bill and Nick Lardy, who's going to speak tomorrow, and Tom, I've learned so much from over the years as well. But it's always been about, you know, the U.S. is a fairly steady a reference point in the equation, fairly, and China moving in relation to it. And now we're at a moment in time where we're really looking at a dynamic situation where everybody's, you know, moving around a bit against what we've traditionally expected. I don't have so much of a speech as a conversation with you, and I'll get it rolling, and then, I don't know, do we have a little time, JC, for some questions and discussion afterwards?
Yeah.
Okay. But, you know, China's at a time when we're contemplating. In fact, the president has literally said he intends to withdraw the United States from various commitments and responsibilities that we've shouldered in over the past century, really. It's not been since we decided to turn our back on the League of Nations, really, which I believe Woodrow Wilson had something to do with this university, that the U.S. has been so on the ropes, on the fence, in terms of what it intends to do internationally. And so, not surprisingly, the country on the rise, China, at the moment, is naturally asked, you know, what it intends to do with that opportunity if we want to consider that an opportunity, the same way Tom Sawyer presents us a fence as an opportunity to paint, if we want to take it. And then ultimately, to what extent is China capable of playing that role? Does it intend to play that role? And if so, is it capable? So this kind of came into focus most immediately last month when President Xi at the Davos meetings in Switzerland gave a stirring address in defense of, in praise of globalization as a phenomenon politically and economically. I think he considered it quite broadly and painted a picture of China helping to lend support to that historical trend toward globalization, more global world. And that wasn't just a one-off. Major elements of Chinese foreign policy, economic and otherwise, have for some years now spoken to a larger role for China on the world stage. It was Bob Zelek who originally said China needs to come out and be a responsible stakeholder. Chinese in foreign policy and economic terms have definitely pointed to evidence that they are doing so, that they are stepping out. So President Xi last month wasn't the first time we've heard this, and it wasn't the last either. Premier Li, right afterwards, published an article via Bloomberg, news of all places, following up and saying China very much intends to take more of a leadership role, step into the vacuum that the U.S. may be creating. I want to leave it aside for the moment whether we should take that assumption at par, that the U.S. will be leaving a vacuum. I'm not at all convinced that, you know, even if President Trump wanted to, he would be able to, in a meaningful way, remove the United States from the position it currently holds internationally. I'm not sure that he's really going to want to once he finally understands what he's doing. But anyway, we're going to leave that aside for now. And assuming that there's a vacuum, some amount of vacuum out there, does China, to what extent can China step into it? The first thing that President Xi spoke to in analyzing the opportunity was the role of innovation in economic globalization. He said that globalization as we know it is very much the process of innovation among nations. As we collaborate together to further technological advancement and innovation, that very much means reducing political barriers to economic activity that stretches across borders, which is a form of innovation in itself because it permits us to use resources which are scarce and endowments, whether they're people or land or resources, in a more efficient way by not being all balkanized into little economic units we call countries, but instead reducing those barriers to allow resources and ideas, ultimately, as Bill just described, to flow more freely, and therefore get to a better, what we might call a technology frontier in our little pretty economic equations and charts of, you know, how much better can we be, how much more innovative can we be today than we were in the past. It shows up in the global gross domestic product equation in various channels, one of which is what we might call long-term technological change, right? After we account for demographic inputs and capital being poured into a machine, how much of the land is not being used for parks and we're going to rip it up and turn forests into paper and thereby, you know, release value. What's left at the end of the day is productivity gain, technological advancement that allows us to do more with less or more with the same resources, right? So this notion of international cooperation around innovation, technological advancement is critical to the question of how well off the planet is. China has been, for millennia, an important node of innovation in the world, but it's just as notable for the obstacles to fully realizing the value and potential of the innovations that China has been party to. Paper, gunpowder, movable type, I mean, the old cliched things that we often point to. And in the modern era, we see so many innovations and business models that seem to be coming out of China. And yet,
As both the previous speakers alluded to, if the political culture does not come around in a way that permits private parties and innovators to use that technology, then you can't ultimately get the value out of it, right? Let's say you have two companies in an economy, and one comes up with a killer application that would allow it to produce the podium I'm speaking from at just a tenth of the price of its competitor. Well, the way market economies are supposed to work, the other company should be out of business in a year, and we should all, as consumers, be better off. But if for some reason politics steps in and prevents a kind of competition or realization of the innovation value that's being created, then everybody's invested in innovating, which is inherently disruptive, but then they can't do anything with it once they've invented it. Similarly, if nations worldwide are more concerned today about Chinese intentions, what they intend to do with technology, if they want to invest in the United States in semiconductors, or in Germany in semiconductor manufacturing equipment as well. And instead of thinking together about whether that makes our economies more innovative, more productive, we're preoccupied with the question about whether there's a mixed motive or intention, whether technological capabilities China has developed an advantage on in the past and tried to use to impose its political will on neighbors and others might repeat itself on a grander, larger scale if China took a more dominant role closer to the cutting edge in innovative industries. And so just as President Xi is talking about, don't worry, China's gonna take the baton of global innovation, which is at the heart of globalization as we've known it over the past three decades, everybody else in the OECD is actually thinking exactly the opposite, unfortunately, thinking about tightening our investment regimes to make it less easy for Chinese companies to invest in our economies, tightening our export control laws and systems, having a very different attitude toward what Chinese participation in the international economy actually means. So far from passing that baton, people are thinking about taking the baton and locking it up in a closet right now. So that's the first flag that we on this story of China assuming the role of American innovation leadership and sort of pushing the process forward. Second, trade. President Xi spoke about global trade growth and global trade dynamics, and China's readiness with the U.S. pulling out of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, with President candidate Trump talking about 45% cross-the-board tariffs on Chinese goods, building a wall with Mexico that is going to impede many elements of economic flow, including trade, to some extent, between us, renegotiating even NAFTA with our closest allies and this sort of thing, right? Is China able to take that baton and become the sort of engine of global trade growth? And it would be terrific if China could and if China would, but the problem there is that part of the Trump revolution and the Brexit revolution and the pressures cooking up in Middle Europe and Germany right now and new thinking about trade policy in Canada and Australia and many other places is a sense that now that China has matured close at this point, even to higher income levels, beyond middle income even within the next decade, we think, we still aren't seeing a willingness to let trade really be free in a sense that would benefit global demand and not just benefit Chinese interests. And so it kind of falls on deaf ears when President Xi talks about China leading trade by getting to a regional trade agreement faster, when if we look at the pattern of Chinese trade in the world, we see this picture. I just brought two slides. They are very light on slides. This is a zero. Anything above it means China is on net running a trade surplus with that region annually, or by month, in fact. Below the zero means China's running a trade deficit with that region on a monthly basis. And the past we're coming from back here with all these bars down below the zero, we used to have a kind of new triangular trade story as we had between Barbados, Britain, and Savannah and New York 300 years ago, right in this country. And in this triangular trade,
the rest of Asia, at least, ran a surplus with China, sending natural resources and intermediate goods. China fabricated them, finished them into consumer goods, put them together, and then they got shipped off to the OECD West for final consumption. And at least that was a flow, and that provided a logic for China's role in Asia, at least, becoming Monroe Doctrine-like, almost, in terms of its leadership role, that there was enough growth that was centered on China that it provided a new kind of geoeconomic gravity to the Asian region, at least. But we look fast forward to today, and for 3 years now, China has had a trade surplus with every region on planet Earth, except for Oceania, Australia, and New Zealand. I often think of an old book called On the Beach by Neville Shute, which some of you will get my joke, that the cloud of trade surplus out of China is just encompassed everything, and you know, will these our friends down under be able to resist very much longer? Well, we'll see. But the problem here is that China regionally is running a surplus even with the rest of Asia, right? And of course with the Middle East and with Africa and with Latin America. So the notion that this is somehow pro-developmental is not matched up right now with the reality of China's global trade patterns. Now, this could shift, and Chinese trade policies could be adjusted in a way which put that surplus back to the world, and hence made a massive contribution to global growth as perceived by the rest of Earthlings who are not under a red flag with yellow stars on it. But in current moment, and there are a number of people here who have who watch global growth and Chinese GDP growth, it's a pretty tough time right now for China to say, you know what, we're going to start running a trade deficit, because things aren't going so well at home in China GDP-wise either. And now more than ever, China wants to kind of keep as much of its external surplus as it can, I would say. So I'm not convinced that China is actually ready to be the engine of global growth from a trade perspective either. I'll move more quickly through the remaining 2 points I was going to make, because I've already probably used most of the time allotted to me. But next on the list of things that are supposed to be good news where China can kind of take the baton right now is global foreign direct investment picture. For all those countries around the world that are no longer looking at being able to ship on net goods, products to China, because China's running a trade surplus with them, well, at least there's Chinese outbound direct investment coming to their economies, as there has been to ours. Last year was a extraordinary record, $46 billion of Chinese FDI in the United States, $40 billion in Europe. Pretty good news, right? And it has been a good news story for the better part of the past decade. The problem with it is on the outbound side, China's ability to invest overseas, we're now tangled up in misgivings about what they're buying and why. Why so much in semiconductor, for example, right? That is complicating the story. Most of it, to my mind, shouldn't be complicated. It's commercial stuff, it makes sense. But like it or not, it partly because of the South China Sea, I would see Tom, China's reputation for its non-interference in everybody else's affairs, that's over. Now we've activated this monster, and we're always gonna be a little skeptical about what Chinese motives and intentions are in our economies, just as in foreign policy as well, I think. So the FDI story that should be feel good isn't so feel good as it was. Some Chinese investors in JVs, joint ventures in the United States, have tried to claim that because they're a state-owned company, they can break contracts and can't be brought to a U.S. court of law by their American JV partner. That's a onerous attempt to get out of a contract that's not working for them, and it was a mistake for them to do that. But this kind of trying to slip through the cracks behavior we're seeing among some of these investors is problematic. Finally, on this point, it's fine for Xi Jinping to say, good news, Chinese firms are going to make $750 billion of investments around the world through 2020, as he said at Davos. But he said, also good news, we expect foreign firms to make $600 billion of investments in China.
That's okay, but why 150 billion less into China than going out? Why is that thinking at the top level of statecraft in the country that there shouldn't be a balance, that China should be building up a bigger foreign asset position than foreign firms are permitted to take inside China? That's just prima facie problematic. And what's the thinking there? Why is that? That's quite concerning. We can talk about it. Finally, financial account opening beyond just direct investment. This should be the golden era of Chinese portfolio outflows, buying investment assets in New York and Philadelphia and London, Sydney, around the world, but also our savings, a small part of it, maybe a couple percent, let's say, being placed into China, into Asia markets in China and Chinese bonds. It should be going in both directions. But as China has taken, this is a snapshot
of China's financial account transactions by Chinese residents. And the point is, what was a fairly balanced picture, where there were some outflows and some inflows, over the past year, in particular, 2 years really, because there's been fumbling in China's macroeconomic reform at home, it's caused a little bit of a panic, shall we say. And the outflows have significantly surpassed what was expected, and the inflows aren't happening the way that planners had hoped. If Morgan Stanley were bringing its $10 billion a year into China's portfolio markets, and 100 other global direct, global portfolio investors were too, we wouldn't have a balance of payments problem. But that's not happening because China's capital markets are all screwed up, I think is the technical term right now. That's resulted in a net outflow of capital from China that scared the pants off of China's leadership, led to the reimposition of capital controls, and a change of focus in our expectations about the benefit of China's globalization 2.0. So instead of focusing on, wow, this is going to be really exciting as capital flows in both directions, instead we're all preoccupied with to what extent is China going to go in reverse and pull back some of the financial account opening it had already undertaken and pledged. Renminbi liberalization, internationalization, done for the time being, because China can't bear the risk of having a renminbi market in Hong Kong, which lets everybody know just what markets really think about China's forward-looking prospects. Not to be too dark then, I'm still bullish, although I think that a lot of problems are going to need to be addressed in a new way with a new urgency in order to get to the bullish future we should all be excited about with China. But when it comes to China's readiness and capacity to take that baton and make up for the U.S. taking a sabbatical, I'm not counting on that for the time being at all. We are still indispensable, provided that we're not ready to live with a big, nasty vacuum in the international economy. We stop there. Thank you.
Great, so we have about 15 minutes left. So we will, let me open it up to questions and comments, and including questions and comments from the panelists. If you have questions, comments on your panelists' presentations, or anyone else? Okay. Yes. Sophie? Sorry.
Okay. Well, thank you. Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks for really a terrific panel. I wish I could ask questions to all of you, but I'm only going to ask one from Dan, the question of investment. How has, now that China has moved from being an investee into one of the top investors in the world, how has that changed the Chinese government's attitudes towards investment regulation? And in particular, the current bilateral investment treaties it's negotiating with both the United States and the European Union, and maybe the possibility of creating eventually some kind of multilateral investment court? And how does that square with the taking the baton of globalization that you were talking about?
It's a really good question, and we've talked about it before. It needs too much time to fully work out, but I will say this. Is this on? Make it easier for some people to hear me in the back anyway. Yeah. I'll speak loud anyway, just in case. But
I think it's
on. Look, Chinese companies operating in the U.S., once you figure out how to do that here or in Europe, something like that, you've learned a lot. And it's very valuable to take that home and start building a more modern kind of governance, more modern approach to dealing with your regulators back home in China. That's really important. But at the national regulatory level, I just want to point to one thing. China can slow down a little bit, its companies going global, but it can't dare stop it. Because China has this massive global trade surplus, it is now contingent on its companies having forward deployed capabilities around the world. If it's not invested in the US, it will no longer be competitive exporting to the US in all the areas where it's currently exporting. Socks and underwear, forget it. They're not the cheapest socks and underwear producers anymore. The problem with that is that you now have a big net outflow of direct investment. And so we're starting to see Beijing come back and say, no, we really want foreign investors coming into China. We're gonna open our door wider because foreign investors are starting to say, we're not going to China anymore. You haven't stayed the course and kept pace with the kind of reform that's required, and we're just not going to do it. So now Beijing is forced to more sort of come to an affirmative action stance, if you will, almost, toward inward direct investment. We're starting to see that right now. I think we're going to see a lot more of it this year.
Yes. My question for Professor Kirby, and it's not about Chinese universities, but about the remark you made about American universities. You said American colleges are declining, and you cited UC Berkeley. I think it's an obvious fact. Now, my question is, other than the size of the endowment in these colleges, what are the factors that drive down American colleges in, say, since the end of the last second half of the century?
Well, I don't want to be perceived to be too negative in this regard. I was looking at what I might call early warning signs of what are the possibilities. Most students in the United States go to publicly funded universities. They have almost throughout the country. I could go on a long time, so I'm not going to. But distinguishing features of the United States, there are really three extraordinary things that distinguish the United States compared to others. One of them is private research universities such as Princeton that are world-class universities by every measure. That's very unusual. Private liberal arts colleges, place of extraordinary energy and innovation in teaching, and with career trajectories that lead to per capita more people going on to PhDs than the great research universities do. And then three, a great tradition of publicly funded higher education and great research universities. And it is that last one that I think where I see warning signs. If you look at funding, University of California, Berkeley has gone from 7 years ago, 25% of its budget from the state to now about 8 or 9% virtually overnight. Some universities, Michigan, have navigated this decline in public funding, but it has a long-term and enduring effect on their capacity to hire and promote the best faculty, to teach well the ever larger numbers of students that they have to accommodate in order to balance the books. And my point, broadly speaking, is that in the world of research universities, these rankings are measured almost exclusively by research and research output, innovation that comes through universities. The great public universities set standards also, not just the private ones. They're much larger. They're more, in areas of engineering and so on, they're really quite dominant, with the exception of a place like MIT. And so as they decline, or if they decline, then the competition, and university is just like business. Competition is the key to innovation and success. Without competition, Princeton and Harvard are not anywhere near as good as they are today. That competition comes in part from the public sector, and that's where I am worried about a decline in our capacities.
My question is for Tom. Your map, you didn't say anything about it, but it showed these great gray blobs that were identified as oil and gas deposits. Now, I've lost track. I thought the conventional wisdom 20, 30 years ago was that this might be a very resource-rich area, and that's why countries were competitive. But I thought, in fact, the resource endowments in this region are more modest than might have been anticipated.
I don't know. I didn't choose those maps because of the oil and gas fields. I chose them because of the clarity of the nine dashed line, and then I got rid of that one to show the conflict. You can see how baroque the second map really was, but it shows how many overlapping claims there are. My sense is that no one really fully knows how much oil and gas is out there. There is quite a bit. There's no question that there's quite a bit in that. China has objected to foreign oil companies operating in places like the Blue Dragon region off of Vietnam, and they're clearly very interested in doing so, and China has threatened them in various ways, saying if you cooperate with Vietnam, then you will have less access to cooperation with us in the future, and that's how China rolls on these issues. So they're fighting over something, so I assume there's something there. I think one of the reasons it hasn't been a hot issue is simply that energy prices have dropped so precipitously, and it's very expensive to get the energy and the oil and gas out of the seabed in the South China Sea. So unless energy prices are very high, it's not a particularly great place to explore. So that's been one of the factors. And I'm no geologist, but I know that in some of the areas of the South China Sea, the beds are like this. So we have the technology now to drill sideways in the seabed, but it's still more expensive. And it's much more expensive than a place like Saudi Arabia where you just jab a straw in the ground and you make oil. So if oil prices drop, it's really the Saudis who benefit quite a bit because they'll always have the cheapest oil. It's the easiest to get at. So they'll always be competitive. But a place like the South China Sea becomes less competitive in a hurry. And fracking has contributed to that. The U.S. being basically a net exporter of energy now is an extraordinary change.
A quick question. Why is it a dash line? Why not a solid line? Can you say between the dashes?
It just shows how accidentally it was all created. My understanding is that Chiang Kai-shek actually drew it at some point. It was 11 dashes. And you know, when you think about mapping, it's like drawing with a crayon, right? The line, the dash itself is like 40 miles wide. There's no rhyme or reason. What connects it? So one of the things that China really needs to do is clarify its claims, try to come up with some historical story of where it comes from, and try to explain how it comports with international law to which China has acceded in 1982. So China has agreed to the international law piece, so it's not as if it's a foreign international. China is part of that system, or is China going to take a legal position which is consistent with its actual behavior, which is to be much more expensive than the law allows? It's challenging aircraft and ships and drones in areas where it has no legal rights. That's a big problem.
Sir,
I would like maybe I can be heard without the microphone. Is that working?
Oh, yeah.
It's working. If I could ask Dr. Rosen again. Following up on that earlier question, I understand the Chinese have lost about a quarter or was the foreign reserve something from four trillion to 3 trillion within the last 3 years. To what extent these are dangerous signals in terms of the planning for, say, the Silk Road and for the East Asian Infrastructure Bank or Reconstruction Bank and other commitments. I know, for example, last week, the first African electrified railroad was completed from Djibouti to Addis Ababa, mostly financed by Chinese. So to what extent is Xi Jinping and his economic team being realistic or just being plain visionary?
That's a wonderful question. And you know, I think there's room for both realism and vision on the part of a nation as extraordinary as China is, right? That said, in a little more than 24 months, China's come burned down from $4.2 trillion in foreign exchange reserves to a stated number of 2.97, with many of us thinking the real number is probably $300 billion lower for various reasons. It's not that $2.5 trillion is not enough to take care of the things that countries need foreign exchange to take care of, which is having enough that there's no question that you can pay for your imports and pay off whatever external debt obligations you have. $2.5 trillion is enough. $2 trillion is enough. If you ask the IMF, probably $1.5 trillion is pretty much enough. It's the slope here that's concerning, and especially the fact that that slope of change was not according to plan. It's the foreign direct investment balance has gone from massive net inflow to significant net outflow in a very short period of time. It's the short and medium term credit debt numbers, and it's the longer term portfolio flows as well, shifting very precipitously. Furthermore, when we look ahead, the expectation is the United States is going to be raising interest rates. The US dollar is very likely to get stronger. All things being equal, that's inclining even more Chinese to try to buy into America or get out of renminbi now rather than later. So it's just building up a tremendous amount of pressure. Now, meanwhile, China has, in no small part for geoeconomic reasons, made these really enormous forward commitments to financing, as great powers are wont to do, let's say, right? We have One Belt, One Road. We have the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, which works in partnership with many other countries, mind you. It's not all just Chinese money there. But there are even more of these funds, the BRICS Bank, Silk Road Fund, China Development Bank, China Exim, which are all China capability. Not only are there new question marks about the ability of all those institutions to do all their financing in dollars, given our concern about the changing position here, and especially the changing position over the next couple of years, if we look at the monetary policy fundamentals in which all this is happening, right? But people's willingness to let that be financed in renminbi is changing too, because people perceive the renminbi to be a currency a little bit at risk right now of a significant devaluation. So it raises really big questions. We're talking 75 countries up and down the belt and the road. China's biggest single a client state for development assistance to date is what?
Pakistan.
Not even Pakistan. That would be better. Venezuela.
Oh.
$65 billion.
That's
dollars,
energy, not infrastructure.
$65 billion, right, of credits extended by China. It's not going to be recovered. They're never getting it back, unfortunately, right? Which is one thing if you have an occasional Venezuela in your portfolio. We can all survive that for a couple quarters, right?
But even the infrastructure is, you know, it's Pakistan, which
but
is
they
not,
also have
Pakistan is the next is number two, and that's not such great news either. I mean,
we have an expert here.
The point I'm making is that if you can stick with it for the long run and you really believe in the growth prospects of these countries, Japan made pretty good returns on its development assistance to China, its biggest borrower ever, after 1980, right? The best money the World Bank ever made, investing into China. The question is, are we going to have more Venezuelas or more Chinas here? Or the question is China going to have more Venezuelas or more of the old China, not the current China that's building up debt liabilities internally at a rate which is scaring the pants off the IMF also?
Yeah, I can remember when I was in the government and people were really concerned that China was moving into Venezuela and was going to get all its influence. And I thought, I just laughed to myself because the U.S. had been the dominant economic player in Chavez's Venezuela. And you can see all the political influence we gained.
So careful what you ask for, you might get it.
So we're almost out of time. Let me take two questions in the back. Yes. Yeah.
I don't think I'll need it.
Just speak loudly, we'll hear you.
Yeah.
I forgot about that.
I'd like to pursue this issue of the staying power and strategy of the United States and China a little bit more. When you look, even with Trumpism, whatever it evolves to be, when you look at the United States' balance sheet in a broad sense, our resources, our obligations, and the trajectory, and you compare that to China, its resources, obligations, trajectory, and their the different strategic objectives of the countries, which country do you think is likely to, assuming no hot war, okay? Which country do you think will overshoot its capacity in terms of its global ambitions and cause significant stress on its system, causing a retrenchment or a financial crisis of some kind?
Let me take one more question and we'll answer. Yes.
I had a question in response to the discussion on trade flows. We showed the shift in the net position of the Chinese trade flow. I was wondering, I'll repeat the question so everyone could hear. We noticed, we discussed how there was a change in the current account that China has with various regions and how that net position went from being a net exporter to all these different regions. I'm wondering what the gross positions are in terms of imports and exports over this time period and to what extent the investment story affects those gross positions as well.
This doesn't work.
It's such an excellent question on the large question of which one will, as it were, overextend itself in a variety of ways. And I think, if you look at recent history, the answer is clear. The United States already has in many ways. That is to say, particularly over the last 15 years, entered in a number of wars that we could not finish, did not pay for them, massive financial disruption within this country in part, but not only. As a result, major strategic and major self-inflicted strategic errors of a kind that will in the long run almost surely not be will have injured the capacity of this country to maintain its leadership position. I think the open question that one should have is, can China learn from the experience of every other major imperial power from the 1840s on, that as trade goes and as disputes arise, as your residents live all over the world, sometimes they ask for your protection, can you avoid the militarization of economic relations in a way that none of the great European powers did and the way that the United States also failed to do in the latter part of the 20th and early part of the 21st century? It's part of the long arc of the history of imperialism and of international military economic relations in the 20th century. I think some good signs are when the Libyan crisis was happening a few years ago, China had some 30,000, 31,000 Chinese residents in Libya, and they got them all out quietly and successfully.
And another 50,000 in addition, they got
Another 50. Okay, so
we
I'm
got
wrong.
80,000.
80,000. I'm my mistake. So Tom 30, knows.
30,000 their own citizens, 50,000 attendant people.
Wow. Okay, and yet the risk, you know, the risk is there in every. I remember, and I'll turn it over to more knowledgeable comrades in a moment. But the risk is there for any country in which the foundation of the regime, which it is much more in China than in the United States, is the military. I remember we had at our Fairbanks Center in recent years several leading Chinese military officials, and one of my comrades asked this leader of the Chinese delegation, why do you keep asking for increases of 10, 15, so on percent year after year after year, when the strategic position of China is actually one of great security? And the answer, which perhaps a professional military person would give in any country, was because we can.
I disagree with Bill. I almost always agree with Bill. He's one of my intellectual heroes. I don't think the United States is overextended in the world. I don't think that's the problem. I think the problem is Americans don't understand the missions of the United States around the world. Those missions are an easy scapegoat for politicians who want to criticize American leadership roles around the world. And we've had some very bad experiences in the last 10 to 15 years, which make it an easier target to criticize American leadership roles around the world. And I'm actually much more concerned that the United States will undershoot rather than overshoot because of this backlash that we're seeing. And Dan laid it out, you know, China can't step in and be a leader on the international economy for various reasons. I agree entirely with him. I don't think there's anybody out there who can replace the United States. The EU certainly can. It's hobbled. And if the U.S. doesn't play that role, I think everybody will suffer, including the United States. And in terms of military, you know, this is an economics conference, you know, at this wonderful center, and I appreciate the center inviting me. The military in the United States is not a major tax on the U.S. economy. It just isn't. It's a much lower percentage of GNP than it's been in recent history. The U.S. economy is much larger than it was in that recent history, when the U.S. paid a much higher percentage of GNP on the military than it currently does. We can afford it. We choose not to afford it because of what Bill said. We don't pay the bills, but that's a choice to not pay the bills. We can afford to pay those bills, and they're a good investment. How you use that investment, where you send the troops, do you kill Gaddafi, do you try to occupy Iraq? Those are questions about how you use the assets, not whether you should have them. And I think the military is a very good investment if we pull back, particularly on our alliances.
Right.
And where the U.S. strength really lies vis-a-vis everybody else in the world, especially China, is in our alliances. We have 60-plus alliances and security partners around the world. What does China have? North Korea.
By the way, in regard to what you said, and since it is a finance economics policy conference, I really believe that the constraint on global liquidity and economic growth will be the fact that if the United States pulls back, as you pointed out, and dollars become more scarce around the world, the lifeblood of the world economy will be more constrained. I think that, because I think the financial crisis of 2008 showed, given the strains in Europe, that in the only real reserve currency
is the dollar. It's one of the great things about the financial crisis to show about the persistence of American leadership. That I hope I don't offend anyone in the room. The U.S. screwed up the global economy, right?
Through its
domestic behavior.
Right.
And where did everybody run?
Dollars.
To the U.S. Because you got to run somewhere, and even the U.S., after it screws up the global economy, is the safest place to be, especially in a storm, even if the storm was created by the U.S.
Right.
So, and that was true for the Chinese, too. So the U.S. is very much a leader, and when the U.S. Adopts short-sighted, stupid policies, right, it hurts everyone, including the United States. So I'm much more worried in the current political environment in the United States that we will fall short, not that we'll overreach. And I think it's a real shame if we don't show leadership. And if we lose our alliances, we've lost a lot in the military sphere. And I just don't understand the logic. So I hope it doesn't happen. And I hope we come around as a nation and understand why we're investing in the military, why we invest in our allies, and that we use those forces prudently. There's no necessity. Just because you have a hammer doesn't mean you have to hammer something. But it's awfully good to have that hammer.
Great. Last question. Do you want to answer the question on gross versus net?
Believe it or not, there's a little bit of a connection between that question and the one that was just discussed. Let's put it in these terms. We looked at the changing structure of China's surpluses abroad, but in the gross picture, China's both its imports and its exports are slowing, and that's a function, principally of China reverting to the mean a bit, and just after 30 years not growing double digits anymore, it's slowing down. But there is still huge, huge potential for China's trade growth to be part of its own renaissance or next phase of development. And that development, if it embraces opportunities that benefit other nations around the world in terms of raw materials, in terms of information communication technologies that we have an advantage producing, but which, because we're losing trust in one another a bit, we're foreclosing opportunities to one another, to be part of one another's success, right? We could have increasing surpluses from China's perspective, but shrinkage both in terms of their imports and their exports, which is symptomatic of a global economy, which is missing its opportunities. So we really can, I think we're all most likely to under-invest in the global opportunities that present themselves to us, which would be a shame. Bill noted earlier the Rhodes Scholars Program as the one of the key antecedents for the Schwarzman Fellows Program. Cecil Rhodes founded that program, I think, in about 1911 or 12 or 10, a mere few years, right? It was founded with the credo that if you could take the best and the brightest from around the world and put them under a single university dome together for a while, you could make sure we get to those great opportunities that come from trusting one another's commerce and engaging with one another. Alas, instead, we had World War I within the first 2 or 3 years of the program being convened for the first time. So hopefully, you know, we don't have to relearn the lessons of history over and over again forever. Although I'm starting to lose that bet that I used to take the progressive side of the wager.
Great. Well, on that note, obviously a lot more questions, but we're out of time. And in fact, I apologize, we went over time. But please join me in thanking our panelists for a very good